across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Brightlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's 6:06 on this Tuesday morning, April 23rd, 2024. Another beautiful day to have you here up north, live from Lake Wissota, from wherever you're listening, across the Civic Media Radio Network, through the app, through social media, maybe by podcast. Nice to have you along. I've got a question for you. I have 4 tickets to give away to the Brewers-Yankees game this coming Saturday at American Family Field, and I don't know how to give them away. I don't know if I'll go with Brewers trivia or music trivia, maybe something about the show. Do you know the name of Greg Bach's dog? I don't know. I got to come up with just the right way to do this. So that's just my way of saying, hey, tomorrow on a Wednesday, we're going to do it Wednesday because it's 4 tickets to Saturday evening's game. And, you know, people sometimes can't give them the tickets on a day's notice and find other people to go. So I think we're going to do it tomorrow. Let's give away 4 tickets to the Brewers-Yankees game coming up this weekend. Whenever we do it, if we take phone calls, here's the number. If you haven't dialed it yet, if you haven't written it down, you know, it changed about a month ago or so. And so this is the new number, 855-75-CIVIC, 855-75-CIVIC. You can call it, or you can text it, or you can use the Civic Media app and call or text us that away too. All right, here's what else is coming up this morning. Before he quit Congress last weekend, Mike Gallagher gave some quintessentially Wisconsin advice to his now former colleagues. More social drinking. We'll explore whether that's really a great idea. Plus, it's Tuesday, so we catch up with 2 of my colleagues from Up North News, Sharita Booker, our social media manager, and Christina Loria, our newspaper or newsletter editor, to find out what's popular in each of their platforms. In our second hour, we'll hear from Vice President Kamala Harris, who made her 3rd trip to Wisconsin this year already, telling a lacrosse audience on Monday that they are doing the right thing to not let up on reminding their neighbors and friends of the dangers to individual liberty in the wake of the Dobbs decision that treats women as second-class citizens when it comes to their health care. We'll also visit with Civic Media reporter James Kelly, who updates some of the stories on his beat, which would be right here in the Chippewa Valley. And Chad Holmes will preview his 8 a.m. show on Bull Falls Radio in Wausau as part of the Civic Media Radio Network. We'll get the forecast from Brittany Merlot and much more on this Tuesday morning. Also wanted to mention that there is a candidate forum tomorrow evening that is going to be carried by 3 of the Civic Media radio stations because we have several stations in or around the 3rd Congressional District, which is currently represented by Derek Van Orden. But there are 3 Democrats looking to replace him, and those 3 candidates will be part of several forums between now and the August primary, and the first one of those will be tomorrow at UW Stevens Point at the theater there at 6:30, featuring Rebecca Cook, State Representative Katrina Shanklin, and Eric Wilson. They will all be there, and you will be able to hear that candidate forum tomorrow evening on locally grown radio, WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids. You'll be able to hear it on the Eagle in La Crosse and on 93.5 The Tap right here in Chippewa Falls. And then there will be forums in, one in May, one in June, one in July. So plenty of opportunities to hear from the people that are running in one of the primaries in one of the congressional districts here in the state. Arguably one of the most watched, along with the 8th in Northeast Wisconsin, now that Mike Gallagher has quit, and the 1st District down in Southeast Wisconsin. So a lot to cover. And we'll come back to Congress and talk about Mike Gallagher's unusual farewell address in just a bit. But first, let's take a look at temperatures around Civic Media World at 6 a.m. It's 47 here on Lake Wissota. It's 34 in Hayward and Park Falls. That's pretty much on par with yesterday. Almost everybody else south of there is anywhere from 15 to 20 degrees warmer than yesterday. Wausau's at 45, Green Bay 50, La Crosse 52, Wisconsin Rapids 51, Oshkosh 53, Madison 53, and Waukesha 52 degrees. Waukesha. What's so special about Waukesha? Oh, Greg Bach is there. Greg Bach in Waukesha right now, where it's 20 degrees warmer than yesterday. But it's going to get cooler tomorrow, as Brittany's going to tell us, because the springtime roller coaster rolls on and on and on and on. Mr. Bach, good morning. And on and on.
Good morning, Pat. Yeah, I mean, I know that spring is a thing, and I'm happy that we're getting, like, a spring. But a spring. We just get a spring for, like, 3 days straight instead of this. Hey, guys, it's 70 tomorrow.
Psych.
12.
Yes.
Thursday, locusts.
Cicadas. It's going to be in the 20s tomorrow morning in many parts of Wisconsin.
Mean.
I know. Just give us the thing. Give us the real spring. Give us the real stuff.
Give it to me. Come on, give it to me.
No more previews.
Yeah.
I just can't. I'm ready for it. As are all the folks who like to do gardening. You know, anything you're growing outside, you don't want to have to worry about the frost and things anymore. I mean, Sherry keeps going out and looking at her tulips, and I just keep thinking, I mean, I know they're hardy and everything, but, you know, some years they come up better than others. Some years the bunny rabbits get really mischievous. there was a beaver going through our yard the other day, and we're on a very high bank over the Chippewa River as it empties into Lake Wissota. So it's very weird to see a critter up on a high bank like we're on, but we have a feeling he was like just surveying the landscape, looking at all the trees on our bank and going, I'm going to take you first, and then you, and then you. And I'm thinking, well, buddy, if you can dam up the Chippewa River, well, good luck. You go get him, guy. It's a big project, but he just might be ambitious enough to try to pull it off.
And then your neighbors were like, hey, Kreitlow's talking to beavers again.
He was pointing at them going, go for that tree there. It's blocking our view of the lake, please. So this was what Mike Gallagher did is interesting, shall we say. And I don't know if, had you seen this already?
I haven't, no.
Okay. I don't recall who put it up on social media first, but and I don't even know yet because I didn't read further on it. I don't even know that he delivered these remarks on the floor of the House or if he simply inserted them into the congressional record. Because all I see was the printed page from the congressional record that includes a lot of, you know, yay for me, I did this and I did that. But then he gets to the second half of it and he says the following. I have a lingering personal regret. I wish I had devoted more time to building personal relationships with my colleagues. Our time here is frenetic, filled with overlapping committee hearings and constant fundraising events. It's hard to carve out time just to get to know your colleagues, to understand their background and motivation, and thereby developing trust. My effectiveness as a congressman wasn't primarily a function of intellect or op-ed writing prowess, and certainly not fundraising. It was a direct result of forging friendships across our caucus, and maybe more importantly, across the aisle. So if there's a lesson in that for my successor or any of my colleagues, it's after a grueling day of 1,000 meetings, still make the effort to get that beer with a member you don't know that well. Drink more, tweet less, get to know your colleagues in real life before trashing them on social media. At the end of the day, Republicans and Democrats, we're all Americans, citizens of the greatest country in the history of the world. Even on our worst day, the world is looking to us for leadership. God bless America. And that was, with that, Mike Gallagher was gone. Now, I don't know which way I want to go first on this, either the encouraging people to drink more or to actually forge personal relationships. Because let's start with that one. Because in that sense, the advice is this. Duh.
Yeah.
I could have told you this a very long time ago. We spend way too much time now, thanks to Orville and Wilbur Wright. Everybody's flying home from Washington, D.C. When once upon a time.
You just blame the Wright brothers.
I'm blaming the Wright brothers for the state of today's
politics.
They've
been having it good for too long.
Yep. In an earlier time, members of Congress stayed in D.C. for weeks or months on end. It was tough on their families, yes, but they went to that knowingly. They got to know their colleagues, and they worked together to solve problems. Now they're all just members of a sports team. you know, team red, team blue, and they're doing whatever it takes to undermine one another. And every so often, when you see people actually getting things done, you come to realize they actually went out and forged personal working relationships with some of these folks. Who knew? Who knew, Greg, that you could actually get to know your coworkers and get things done together?
Well, I'm sure that when Mike Gallagher said drink more, Derek Van Orden stood up and said, on it, and just like stormed out of the room.
And then he said, tweet less.
He's like, whatever, man.
Yep. No, dude. Yeah. At first, I thought I misread it. I thought it was drink less, tweet less. And I thought, oh, who's he taking a shot at? But then I looked again, like, oh, no, it says drink more, tweet less.
This is something that frustrates me with all outgoing politicians. And honestly, a lot of times it frustrates me most with GOP members. This bipartisan hooray for all of us wisdom or humor they try to impart while exiting or after they're out of office. While they're in office, they're towing the party line to almost a detrimental effect. But when they're leaving, it's like, my time here was spent with friends across the aisle. You guys don't talk to each other.
Right.
Because if you do, you get in trouble with the caucus. You get in trouble with the base. You get in trouble with the news. You get in trouble. But then as soon as you're out the door, you're like, we just need to come together. We need to work as a country because we are the greatest country on the planet of America.
And then he ends with, even on our worst day, the world is looking to us for leadership. Well, Mike, where's the leadership in quitting?
Yeah.
Again, I know you're frustrated, or maybe some other opportunities came up. But in my mind, barring something rather extreme, you know, that your family's going to completely fall apart or something. Again, you know what you signed up for. And now you're leaving the 8th district seat open. There's no congressional representative until next January. So I appreciate the advice. I kind of chuckle at the drinking more, but I understand what he's saying is get to know your colleagues. But in the end, this is your farewell address, and it's April.
Yeah.
That's not responsible. It's not leadership.
Enjoy your new job with that defense company.
Good job. Whatever it might be. Hey, you got away from the circus, but again, you signed up for it. When we come back, we'll unpack some of the news from today. We'll also talk a bit later about how Taliesin, the Frank Lloyd Wright masterpiece, is seeing an uptick in business thanks to those chef testants at Top Chef. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin, when you're here, you're up north, live from Lake Wasota on the Civic Media Radio Network. And now with us is Sherita Booker, social media manager for Up North News, a separate entity from Civic Media. We hasten to remind you, it just means that if we do something wrong, you know, we get in trouble on our own, us and Courier Newsroom, not Civic Media. But thrilled to be here, taking up some of their valuable real estate for 2 hours every weekday morning. Sherita, good morning. How are you doing?
Good morning, Pat. Good. How are you?
Very good. Thanks. We're going to start with something newsy as we review three of the stories that get either clicked on a lot or commented on a lot. And that was certainly the case with one of our news stories where Ron Johnson was on some right-wing channel someplace, and I thought the video that you put together kind of performed a necessary public service of fact-checking.
Yep, absolutely. So Senator Ron Johnson said in an interview that mail-in voting lacks safeguards, suggesting that it allows undocumented migrants to vote. But that is false. Voting by mail is safe and accurate. That post had almost 500 likes and more than 100 comments. Kim said if he would read his own state election laws, he wouldn't be spewing this trash. And Lona said, what an uninformed elected senator. He shouldn't have never been reelected.
And of course, you know, there are people that because they hear him and other folks in right-wing media say it over and over again, they have convinced themselves that some of these things are true. They are not. Voting by mail has always been safe. It has always been well reviewed. Your local clerks know when a ballot comes in. If it's one that they sent out, they have the registration rolls right in front of there. So these kinds of scare tactics are just, they're not helpful at all. Voting by mail was something that Republicans also welcomed and used for years until Donald Trump needed to blame somebody for his loss. But like I said, with all the likes that were noted on there, I think they appreciated the work you were doing there, Sherita, to, you know, make sure that we put the right information out compared to what our senator is saying.
Yep, absolutely. And everybody can't physically get to the polls, so you have to think about that.
Of course, yeah. And again, that's another talking point that I always will never hesitate to address, where people are like, well, voting's a privilege, not a right. And, you know, you just have to come somehow or another. No, voting is a right. And that includes finding ways for people who may have, you know, disabilities or crazy work schedules, finding opportunities for them to take part in democracy. All right. Grandpa's done with a lecture. Let's move on to the fun stuff here. A lot of responses for the post about how the legendary Ishnala Supper Club is officially open for the season out near Wisconsin Dells. Tell us more about that, Sherita.
That's located on Mirror Lake and is surrounded by hundreds of acres of state forest. The only downside is they do not take reservations, so be prepared to wait. That post had more than 400 likes. And Kevin said, been waiting in line since December. And Sandy said, interesting and wonderful place to visit. The food was phenomenal.
It really is. We went there for our one and only time so far 2 summers ago. We got there pretty much right when it opened, but so many people were already in line that meant for us about a 3-hour wait, but it was gorgeous weather. And like you said, you're right there on Mirror Lake. There's some, you know, little trails to walk around on and, you know, plenty to keep you occupied. I think it's also to work up an appetite, but the food is definitely worth it. You know, it was for our visit, but I would also hasten to add, there are a lot of supper clubs around Wisconsin. So if you don't make it to Ishnala, there are plenty of others to get to as well. But yeah, if you're in the Wisconsin Dells area, it's one to hit. I don't know if it holds any interest for you next time you're up in the Dells area, if you're willing to wait, but you know, it is a good meal. I'll say that much.
It does. But only downside is when I go to the Dells, I bring my kids and they are not waiting multiple hours.
that is a very good point. Yes. It may not be for the little ones. It may not be best for them, given the amount of waiting that can sometimes get involved, or just any supper club whatsoever. I mean, you like, what's the favorite frozen custard place you like to go to?
Frozen custard? I would say Cops.
Yeah, Cops. Okay. And that one you can bring the kids to.
Yes, that's quick and easy.
You're not waiting 3 hours for that one. No. Here's something that people wait months for. They wait for not just any migratory birds to come back to Wisconsin, but in particular, the hummingbirds. And there's a very cool way that it's being illustrated in one of our online posts.
Yeah, so we have a map that's showing like all the hummingbirds on their way back to all the states, particularly Wisconsin, hopefully dependent on the weather. And we asked you, how do you attract them to your backyard? That post had almost 1,000 likes and shares. So people they're loving the hummingbirds. Ellen said, one feeder went up today. I have 4 feeders and go through about 20 gallons of juice per summer. Jennifer said, sugar water feeders and a flower garden. And Susan said, I plant salvia, specifically hot lip salvia, which is red. The hummingbirds love it and are there constantly.
My wife has a hanging plant. I believe it's a fuchsia, and it's in the corner of the deck. And I mean, the hummingbirds just love it, love coming to that. So if you can find a hanging basket, a hanging plant that hummingbirds like, you can always give that a go. And that way you're not juggling the, you know, the sugar water and having to clean out the feeder all the time. I'm sure it's worth it either way when you get the hummingbirds coming. But, you know, just keep in mind, there might be all kinds of different options, all these different options for attracting different birds, Sherita. We have orioles come through for about a week in the spring, clearly on their way to other places up north. And some people will put out like half an orange and attract them. Others have different kinds of seeds to attract their own different types of birds. And I find it all fascinating, but I'm glad we can just hang a plant and get some little visitors that way.
Right. Then you're not attracting any other animals or...
Oh, right. Yes. With the bird feeders occasionally attract bears, and definitely the squirrels have had, you know, how do I put this? Our squirrels are fat, Sharita. They can get to our bird feeders way too easy. But if you'd like to follow her post on the hummingbirds or anything else that she does, check us out on all the good social media platforms. Search Up North News or Up North News WI. We'll get you there. Sharita Booker, thanks for your time. As always, have a great day. It is 6:27 right now. The Brewers fell in the series opener in Pittsburgh last night 4-2. Though the Pirates were due for a good game, having come into the matchup riding a six-game losing streak, the Brewers snapped their four-game winning streak as well. Brewers starter Joe Ross went 5 1/3 innings. He gave up 2 runs on 6 hits, but it was fielding errors that allowed the Pirates to grab the lead. Rhys Hoskins homered for the crew. The big news is more pitching injuries. Wade Miley, who was supposed to be tonight's starting pitcher, was placed on the 15-day injured list with left elbow inflammation. He joins left-hander D.L. Hall, who went on the IL because of a left knee sprain on Sunday. And then right-handed pitcher Jacob Junis was taken away in an ambulance yesterday after being hit in the neck by a line drive during batting practice. Junis remained down for about 20 minutes while being treated by medical teams. He was alert when carted away. So the Brewers starting pitchers for the next three games are TBD, TBD, and I kid you not, TBD. To be determined, but they will go again this evening with somebody on the mound. You can listen starting at 5:05 on News from the Center and Richland Center, WRJN and Racine Kenosha, Oshkosh Air Support as well. And of course, game two for the Milwaukee Bucks playoff series against the Indiana Pacers is tonight at the Fiserv Forum. Giannis not likely to play. You can listen starting at 7 o'clock tonight for the Bucks game on Lake Erin Amory, 98Q Country in Park Falls, and locally grown radio in Wisconsin Rapids. Christina Lurie coming up next with The Uplift here up north. Cause I need you. Welcome back. Time for The Uplift here on this Tuesday morning on Up North News Radio. Christina Lurie joins us, as she often does, to tell us what kinds of stories you can find in our newsletter. Sign up at upnorthnewswi.com. Good morning, Christina.
Good morning, Pat. How are you?
Good, thank you. We have a sports theme going here. There's plenty of heavy news that goes on in the world. There's plenty of light news about, you know, food and events, but sports stories tend to resonate well, especially the ones you find that, you know, find people that are either interesting, or my experience is you find people who are motivating because of good things that they do. And we're going to start with women's volleyball this week.
And sports in Wisconsin are that one thing that really shows that we can be all on the same page about something. We root for very similar teams, most of us here in the state. And the University of Wisconsin is obviously one of them. The women's volleyball team, in case you haven't been following for the past few years, they've just been incredible. They've set attendance record after attendance record. Last season, the Badgers-Marquette game brought in 17,000 fans to the Fiserv Forum. And Wisconsin already owns attendance records at the Kohl Center, which is their home court here in Madison. And they are going back to the Fiserv Forum. Tickets go on sale. They are actually on sale right now to catch them in the Women's College Volleyball Showcase.
Okay.
Which is coming up. And it'll be exciting to see them on another big stage. It's just nice to see women getting opportunities. That was something that really just came. I mean, it was like the top story of last week with Caitlin Clark and the draft, and finally eyes on women in basketball. The same things happens for women's in volleyball. And what's unique about Wisconsin is in both volleyball and hockey, with the women's teams arguably have larger fan bases than their male counterparts.
Oh yeah, I mean, you see that in the national numbers where some of those women's games, the championship game topped like every men's game and pretty much everything except some NFL games. So yeah, there's definitely been a pivot, a corner has been turned in terms of, you know, getting people interested, and I think. Well, there are multiple reasons for it, but one thing that really stuck out to me after Caitlin Clark was drafted was the salaries. The salaries are like, at first I heard somebody say, oh yeah, Caitlin Clark's going to get like $350,000. I'm like, really? Yeah. Yeah. Spread over 4 years. Because it's like $75,000 to $90,000. So maybe the TV ratings have caught up. The paycheck sure haven't.
And the thing about that is that there's always the debate about, you know, athletes and their exorbitant salaries. And that's an entirely different issue that I think we can both agree should be tackled a little bit. It would be nice to see teachers and doctors making more livable wages, let alone, you know, anything within the ballpark of these incredible athletes. But when you compare people that are very much the same, you know, the men's number one draft pick last year made millions, signed this giant blockbuster deal and got all kinds of signing bonuses. And then this athlete that, I mean, can you name last year's number one NBA draft pick? Because I can't. No. And if you took a poll on the street, I guarantee most people would know Caitlin Clark by name.
Yes, they would. They would. And I do see this continuing, even though, you know, Caitlin Clark has moved on. The fact of the matter is, like you said, the Badger women's hockey team, the volleyball team, you know, they've turned into like mini dynasties. And so, you know, people will come and go. But if the Badger program is good, then it's going to get people in the seats. It's going to get eyeballs on the TV.
And I'd also be interested to see if Wisconsin volleyball does what Nebraska has done this, and then the Hawkeyes did it for basketball, where they actually played inside of their football stadium so they could set even more attendance records and play in front of record crowds because, you know, Wisconsin's volleyball attendance record. They held the title for the highest in the NCAA for quite a while, but then Nebraska topped it because they played inside of their football stadium last year. But it would be cool. I mean, I'd love to see that at Camp Randall.
Oh, without a doubt. They definitely get the turnout there. And I would like to see that. I hope they can do something with that. In terms of basketball, now again, we like watching basketball at all levels here. We certainly have enjoyed the Bucks past couple of years with Giannis, you know, but even say the state high school boys and girls basketball tournaments always get nice viewership over a couple of day period. And of course the Badger basketball teams, I have to say, especially the men for the longest time, they've enjoyed a rather popular run. Just all in all, we like our basketball here.
We do, and we have like two bits of good news that tackles both college and high school sports. So right now there's a thing going on called the Portsmouth Invitational Tournament, and it's been the NBA launching pad for many names that are now household names like Scottie Pippen, Tim Hardaway, Dennis Rodman, Jimmy Butler, just to name a few from the past few decades. So every year, only 64 college athletes are invited to that tournament to play in front of NBA and professional scouts. And we have two Wisconsin connections in that. We have number 5, Wisconsin's Tyler Wahl, the 5-year starter that was just posted incredible numbers all season. He owns several records as well. Just a refresher, he set the program record for most games played, 162, 120 starts, 1,350 points, 800 rebounds. The impressive numbers go on and on. But he's also joined by a former 2019 Wisconsin Mr. Basketball, Marcus Damask, who played this past season at Illinois, made it to the Elite Eight. He was really the only player from the Illini that showed up for that Elite Eight game against the ultimate champions, UConn. But he was also invited to this tournament, which is really incredible. And as an Illini fan as well, I'm interested to see what he does next season because he is getting scouted this last week. And then he also filed for a medical extension because he missed some games during his NCAA career. So he's looking to possibly return for another season for college basketball, which would be interesting.
Well, and that, again, with so many going into the pros right away, you know, you usually don't see that kind of familiarity anymore. Again, another reason that kind of explains some of the women's popularity is that they hang around for all 4 years and there's so much one and done amongst the men's teams.
And another just reason to love Marcus Damask and be proud that he's from Wisconsin. He made for the second consecutive year the National All-American Academic First Team. He has a GPA last year's GPA was 4.0. This year he dipped to 3.96.
Slacker.
But still incredibly impressive to make, not only make the All-American academic team, but be first team 2 years in a row.
That is. That's good news. It's such a good reflection. All right. And then last to discuss is the NFL draft. We're about 48 hours away from that happening in Detroit this year. But, you know, it's going to be in Green Bay before you know it. And it's become such an event now, you know, totally made for TV. Nothing like it used to be, just a bunch of guys sitting around, you know, a bunch of tables and landline phones. It's a big thing. And a little preview of coming attractions for Green Bay.
And it's a giant economic driver, too. And it's about as close as Green Bay can get to the excitement of the Super Bowl. I mean, unless some major changes happen, they'll likely never host a Super Bowl just because there's all kinds of
winter
strings that they have to have. They have to have a certain number of diamond grade golf courses within a certain radius. And the bench seating at Lambeau doesn't count. So this is basically our Super Bowl. That's slotted for next year. But just talking about this year's draft, and, you know, everyone's wondering who the Packers will pick. So we thought it would be fun to look back and do a little history at the Green Bay's best, most recent draft classes. So 2008 really stuck out. That was the year of Jordy Nelson, Jermichael Finley, and Josh Sitton. Then the next year, 2009, another blockbuster year, Clay Matthews, TJ Lang, BJ Raji. Then we skip forward to 2013. That's where we got David Bakhtiari, Mika Hyde, Eddie Lacy, and then 2014, Devontae Adams and Corey Linsley. Those were just some packed years that set the Packers up for a lot of success. So it'll be really interesting to see what players, you know, what the missing puzzle pieces that they get to deal with Jordan Love. But do you have a particular class that stuck out to you?
Well, I mean, 14 for Devontae, just because he's Devontae. Doesn't matter who else was drafted that year. But I mean, if you're going to go with an entire class, I'd have to say the 08 one with Jordy and Finley probably gets the nod. But you know.
And if you want to throw it real far back, 1956 was a pretty stellar year. Bart Starr, Forrest Gregg. And then 58, you got Jim Taylor, Jerry Kramer, and the namesake of the field, Ray Nitschke.
I mean, look, in complete and total hindsight, those were pretty good drafts. I think they did all right for themselves on there. That's great. So is it something that you would like to be a part of next year? Would you like to travel up there?
I'm hoping you guys will send me there. It's fun to see the NFL recognize some of, you know, these quote unquote smaller cities. I think they had Kansas City host it last year. Detroit this year, you know, it's usually in like the LAs or I do think Chicago is hosting a draft coming up as well, but they're the giant cities. It's fun to see them outside of New York, outside of, you know, the top three metros in the country and come to a place like Green Bay. We started on the topic of our country being divided and there's being a lot of negative news and sports being the one thing that unites us all. And the Packers are really the epitome of that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's this team that's owned by the people, the smallest NFL market in the country, and yet one of the most intimidating to play at because of all the fans that turn out.
It's just what we do here, and we like our sports, and we love it, especially when our sports teams are good to us through good drafts and through, you know, good program development, like at the college level. And that's why stories like these resonate so well in our daily newsletter. So sign up for it if you aren't already. Christina Lurie puts those together along with plenty of other news as well. But like I said, we love our sports. So thanks for giving us a little sample of all the sports stories you've been covering. Have a great day. We'll talk to you a little later.
Bye, Pat.
We have limited our coverage of the Top Chef Wisconsin series to Thursday mornings with Luke Mathers, a big Top Chef fan, in part because we want it fresh the next day, but also in part because somehow we've managed to trigger Greg Bach every time we use the word chef testis.
Why? So why? There was... Why?
So... There, I've made my point. But I wanted to note that the Wisconsin State Journal had a story about the uptick in interest in Taurine Taliesin. Frank Lloyd Wright's little home base there because of the Top Chef episode that was centered around Frank Lloyd Wright and time spent at Taliesin. You know, Top Chef aired April 10th. And since that time, Carrie Rademacher, executive director of Taliesin Preservation, said that they've had 20,000 new users to its website.
Wow. 176
of them making reservations for tours.
Dang.
And so that's an additional 27,000 in revenue right there, just from the initial pop. I've not toured Taliesin. I know you passed by it on our way to House on the Rock.
Yeah.
So I know we toured that, but we didn't have time to do Taliesin as well. It's a UNESCO World Heritage site on 800 acres. So like I said, I've never been. I don't know. You have not?
I've never been there. I spent a long time working in Racine, so I'm very well. I know Frank Lloyd Wright work. The Johnson
from the
family
SC Johnson campus.
Wingspread, their campus. Wingspread is one of the most amazing buildings I've ever seen in my life. And for funds, went to a thing called Brick World, which is a Lego convention a couple of years back, and there was someone who built Frank Lloyd Wright houses out of Lego, and they were breathtakingly beautiful.
Wow.
Yeah. It's like you're like I'm just going to put all of my sets away because I will never do anything but make a dragon.
Look, it's the Lego sets themselves, you know, of course, are getting fancier and more detailed all the time, but even before that, a couple of years back, especially during the pandemic, could not believe how many adults were actually Lego aficionados, you know, building things because they were on house arrest, basically.
I built 40 sets in a year and some change.
Oh my gosh, you too?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I remember our friend Scott Ross actually did like a weekly video podcast while he would talk politics while building with Legos.
Yep.
We all have our ways of working out our energy. Today's history lesson coming up next. You're up north. Every time I look into your loving eyes. Roy Orbison was born this day in 1936. Which would, what, make him 88 years ago he was born. But sadly, he died in 1988 at the age of 52. You Got It Here was one of his posthumous hits, co-written along with Tom Petty and Jeff Lynne. George Harrison was in the studio as well. So we'll hear a little bit more Roy Orbison throughout the course of the morning. I would dare say one of those folks I didn't really appreciate till he was gone. I knew he was there. I knew Oh Pretty Woman from 1964.
Yeah. I was lucky. My father adored him, so Roy Orbison was in the house. Like,
oh, that.
Yeah, yeah. It was just, oh, the voice. Like, someone said it perfectly. It's hauntingly beautiful.
Without a doubt. Yes. We all know that once Charles became King of England, he became King Charles III. Here's your little history tidbit for today. When was King Charles II? Well, he was crowned on this day in 1661. Oh, were you going to guess?
No, I was going to look at the sheet.
Don't raise your hand. The cheat sheet's right in front of you there.
What will I look like? Some kind of king guy knower or something? Please.
King guy knower. 1661, the crowning of King Charles II. The number one song this day in 1977. Well, if it's 1977, it's the disco era. Here's Thelma Houston.
Oh, no. Talk for a second. I didn't get that one song. I apologize.
Here, from 1977, is the remake of a Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes song called Don't Leave Me This Way. Number one on this day in 1977.
Look at that. It's just so smooth, that transition. How did I... I love this song.
I mean, not enough to cue it up, but I mean, yeah,
you can Pat, like it. All right. We all can't be perfect Kreitlow.
Yeah, you know what? I cue up none of these. That's all on you, and I appreciate that.
Thank
more
you.
Than I can possibly say. You are the classic Coke to my new Coke, which was released on this day in 1985 and was a spectacular failure.
Well, at least you didn't call me Crystal Pepsi, so...
No. I was one of the weirdos. I liked New Coke. And now I get to drink it every day. It's now called Coke Zero. I don't know if it's the, I doubt that it's the same, but it tastes close enough to it that that's my beverage of choice now.
Yeah.
Coke Zero, because it tastes like New Coke. But yeah, I remember everybody else just went wild. Like, you can't do this. You can't change this. And Coca-Cola eventually, after a couple of months or so, said, oh, guess you were right. Guess we should change that back.
And could you imagine if they tried to do that today? Like, they would say New Coke now. They'd be like, Coke is canceled. Coke is un-American. Kid Rock would be blowing Coke away on a side of a lake with bullets and a missile. I mean,
you're right. It's so different. You can't just say, nope, something's not going to work. It's now cancel culture. Yeah. Kenny Chesney released his sixth studio album on this day in 2002. And I would dare say, while he was established already, it was this album and this title track that really kind of gave him a lane. And he's been in kind of the Jimmy Buffett lane of country music ever since. No shoes, no shirt, no problem.
No shoes, no shirt, and no problem.
There were five singles there that went top 10. It was his first album to hit the top of the country chart and the Billboard 200 chart. Birthdays today, legendary Milwaukee baseball pitcher Warren Spahn was born this day in 1921. Child actress turned advocate Shirley Temple was born this day in 1928. Actress Valerie Bertinelli is 64 years old today. Everybody remembers little teenage Valerie from One Day at a Time back in the 70s. And George Lopez is 63 years old today. The number one song this day in 1983 was by the one-hit wonder group Dexy's Midnight Runners. The number one song this day in 1988 was Whitney Houston's Where Do Broken Hearts Go? It was her seventh number one song at that point in 1983. Two people sharing the exact same birthday, born the same day, clearly not exactly a case of separated at birth. John Cena is 47 years old today. John Oliver is 47 years old today. So if that's not an advertisement to eat your Wheaties, I don't know what is.
He made a point of that one time on the show, like he had John Cena on to do some bit or something. And he goes, John Cena and I are the exact same age.
And that's all I have to say. It gets a laugh just by looking at them right there. It was like Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito.
Yeah,
you know, in Twins.
It was
along those lines. Okay, something a little melancholy here. Going back to 2016, when Prince had passed away a couple of days earlier, Bruce Springsteen saluted him by opening his show in Brooklyn. The E Street Band was all dressed in purple instead of their usual black, and give a little bit of listen, to the boss giving a tip of the cap to Purple Rain.
I only wanted to see you laughing.
I would dare guess not a dry eye in the house on that.
You can hear the audience singing with him. It's
Yes, you can't quite catch it here from us yodeling over it, but yeah, I caught that last night, cueing this up. The audience in the background just was letting loose. Niles Lofgren had the guitar solo in this one as well. Also on this day in 1968, during the Vietnam War, student protesters at Columbia University in New York City took over administration buildings and shut down the university. I only note that because of the current controversy at Columbia University in New York City. One thing, Greg, I wanted to tell you about, finally late last night, I'm a little tired. I stayed up a little bit past my bedtime, but I just wanted to finish it. I finally finished, and this is an old one, I get it, but I'm late to these things, Steve Martin's memoir of his stand-up days called Born Standing Up.
And?
Such a good book. Yes. I cannot believe I waited all these years to read it.
Oh, well, you got there, and if anyone out there is interested, you should read that book. It's a very interesting read. But I also would suggest the audiobook because listening to him tell the story is very wonderful. Mm-hmm. And just that idea that he was the biggest comedian in the world, and then he was just like, and I'm done with this now.
And I'm done, because he realized what a lonely existence it had been for a myriad reasons. We'll tell you what's on the national day calendar coming up in a bit. We'll hear from Vice President Kamala Harris during her trip to the La Crosse area, and James Kelly, reporter for Civic Media, with some of the stories he's following, all in our second hour of Up North News Radio. Back in a bit.
All times are changing.